Throughout 60 years of Godzilla films, no installment in the franchise has generated as much passionate hatred from the fanbase as the 1998 Roland Emmerich directed Godzilla. It was one of the most hyped movies of that year for many reasons, with perhaps the biggest being that this was the first opportunity the United States had to create their own Godzilla movie from scratch, a chance to translate Japan's most beloved icon for Western audiences. The idea of making an American Godzilla movie had actually been brewing for some time throughout the early 90s, until Tristar acquired the rights from Toho in 1992. And following Godzilla vs. Destoroyah in 1995, which concluded the then current Japanese series with Godzilla's tragic death, Toho officially retired their Godzilla productions to open the way for this big budget American version, which they were very excited for. This film was originally going to be based on a script by Terry Rossio and Ted Elliott, which made Godzilla a creation of the lost city of Atlantis, a creature made to defend the Earth against a shape-shifting alien monster called the Griffin. However, Tristar thought the budget was too high. Tristar then approached director Roland Emmerich and producer Dean Devlin, the duo responsible for Stargate and the then in production Independence Day. They immediately threw out the Rossio and Elliott script and started over. They returned to the idea of Godzilla being a product of radiation and dropped the Griffin in favor of making a film closer in tone and style to the original Gojira. Production began in 1997, and after the immense success of Independence Day, anticipation for the new Godzilla became intense. The marketing came out strong right off the bat, with teasers placed in theaters a full year before its May 1998 release. I still remember seeing the now infamous New Year's Eve teaser on television in 1997. At this time, I had no idea an American Godzilla movie was coming, so when I saw that teaser, I freaked out. I raced to my parents, needing to explain to them what I saw and how excited I was. Needless to say, they had to calm me down. And so began what still seems like one of the most bloated marketing campaigns in movie history. We were teased with posters, billboards, and Taco Bell tie-ins, all promoting the size of Godzilla, building up the movie as an event, intentionally keeping Godzilla hidden so as to compel you to see it opening weekend. Again, this was right after Independence Day, and Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin were riding high off its success. They were the kings of destructive spectacle at the time, and it felt only natural that they were helming a version of Godzilla made especially for the United States. The excitement across the pop culture sphere was electrifying, especially for a young and burgeoning Godzilla fan such as myself at the time. You simply couldn't escape Godzilla, and it was glorious. And then the film came out, and of course it ended up being a pretty big critical disappointment. For Godzilla fans, however, Godzilla 98 wasn't merely a bad film, it was a monumental disaster, first and foremost because it made massive alterations to our beloved monster, to the point where you have to question whether you can even call it Godzilla. In fact, whether deservedly or not, the majority of the criticism levied towards the Roland Emmerich Godzilla tends to be aimed at the monster itself, and it's understandable why. I mean, just look at it. It looks almost nothing like Godzilla. Sure, it retains some of the core features such as the spikes on his back and the trademark roar, but other than these perfunctory features, it doesn't look like Godzilla at all. Really, the only connection is that he's a giant lizard. But other than that, any similarities are minor compared to the drastic changes made in other areas, such as the extended arms, elongated iguana-like head, and more hunched-over dinosaurian stance. However, to play devil's advocate, is this necessarily a bad thing? What am I saying? Of course it is. But if you remove the connection to Godzilla, it's actually easy to like this design. It's sleek, lean, and just plain cool-looking. As a boy who grew up obsessed with dinosaurs, the connection that eventually led me to Godzilla in the first place, this design is pretty impressive in itself. Unfortunately for this movie, however, you can't really remove the connection to the Japanese version. It's called Godzilla, and as Godzilla, it strays way too far from what you expect the character to look like. And the changes go much deeper than mere appearances. To understand the full extent of these changes, you first need to understand what defines Godzilla and why he has endured for 60 years. Godzilla was originally the embodiment of Japan's fear of atomic power. It's astounding to think that they are still the only nation to have actually experienced and feel the full extent of this power. It changed who they are as a country, understandably so. The original Gojira was an expression of these feelings told in a monster movie, with Godzilla as a living, breathing atomic bomb. He's hundreds of feet tall, walks through buildings like they are paper, breathes concentrated nuclear energy, and no matter what the pitiful humans throw at him, he cannot be stopped. It takes an even worse super weapon to defeat Godzilla, and the film ends acknowledging the depressing reality of this realization. This is why, aside from the recent Shin Gojira, the original Gojira is the only film in a series consisting of 29 films that can truly be considered meaningful art. That's not to say that subsequent films weren't important, they very much were. If it weren't for the evolution of Godzilla into a hero figure, he likely wouldn't be as relevant and culturally significant as he is today. But no matter the changes, whether unstoppable force of nature or savior of mankind, Godzilla always retained the core characteristics that defined his character. He was always indestructible, always able to breathe radioactive fire, and always looked relatively the same even with all the physical changes over the years. Even when his origins are radically altered, such as in 2001's Godzilla, Mothra, and King Ghidorah, a giant monster's all-out attack. Jesus, that title is ridiculous. He's still the same character. He may be possessed by spirits, but he's still the Godzilla we know and love. This brings us to Emmerich's Godzilla. The film actually starts off very faithfully, showing how Godzilla was created by a reckless abuse of atomic power via bomb testing. Sure, it's a marine iguana that gets mutated instead of a dinosaur, but that's fine and fits with the more realistic take on the character that's to be expected out of an American production. Despite this faithfulness to the origins, however, what ends up on screen isn't Godzilla. Instead of an unkillable deity ruthlessly responding to the follies of man, he is depicted as a mere animal, a new species we unknowingly created simply trying to find a suitable habitat to reproduce, which for some reason is the heart of Manhattan. Gone is his atomic breath, along with his invulnerability to human weaponry. In fact, he's actually very susceptible to attack, as evident when Matthew Broderick's character Nyctatopoulos finds blood. He makes up for this weakness by evading the military, outmaneuvering them and making them look like idiots. This change means that instead of getting scenes of Godzilla decimating the military, we get him running and hiding. This might just be the single biggest problem with this interpretation of Godzilla. It changes the very fundamental core of the character, and thus all the thematic meaning around it. It's just some big lizard trying to lay eggs, which isn't necessarily a bad idea for an original monster movie, but not Godzilla. And I still remember the absolute shock I experienced when I first saw Godzilla get killed by missiles on the Brooklyn Bridge. It is so antithetical to what a Godzilla movie should be about that it feels inherently wrong. Again, not a bad ending to an original monster movie, but for Godzilla, it is a slap in the face to the character. Then there's the entire baby Godzilla subplot, which is another significant problem with this movie's portrayal of Godzilla. Yes, Godzilla has had a son, but he has never been pregnant. This is where the film really suffers, as it sidelines Godzilla halfway through just so it can devolve into a cheap knockoff of the Velociraptor sequences in the Jurassic Park movies. This whole segment of the film, along with the design of Godzilla, really shows that this film was trying to compete more with Jurassic Park than be an actual Godzilla movie. Not surprising given that the Jurassic Park films were the biggest blockbuster franchise at the time, but it makes this movie even more unremarkable. Ultimately, the fact is that Toho trusted the US with their most beloved character, an icon of Japan, and they screwed it up. This was a chance to introduce the average American audience member to Godzilla, most of whom had never seen a single film and only knew of the character through cultural osmosis, and it completely failed in this regard. Luckily, this would eventually be rectified by the excellent Warner Brothers Godzilla in 2014, but Emmerich's Godzilla still remains a massive missed opportunity. As for the movie itself, there really isn't much to say about it, but you've no doubt heard critic after critic tear into this movie as if it's some sort of cinematic abortion, when really it's just an average monster movie that uses the Godzilla name to get you to see it. And I have to admit, there are some visually compelling sequences in this film. Godzilla's first arrival is built up fairly well, and the way the sequence teases his appearance by only giving us glimpses of his legs and tail is pretty effective. Again, the monster itself is a great design, and whenever he's on screen, it's a fun watch. The problem is that he isn't on screen all that much, especially in the final third. Instead, you're forced to spend long chunks of the running time with bland, unremarkable characters. That being said, let's be honest here, they are a step up from the majority of the human characters in most Godzilla movies. Nobody watches a Godzilla movie for the human characters. It's practically a tradition of the series to sit through the human scenes waiting for the monsters to show up. The 98 Godzilla keeps with this tradition, and as far as the series goes, it falls in the upper echelon of Godzilla movies in this regard. There are far worse human scenes to suffer through, believe me. Ugh. The quality of the acting and writing has also been heavily criticized, and while much of it is deserved, within the prism of a Godzilla movie, it's not that bad. Again, as far as human sequences go, Emmerich's Godzilla isn't the worst. Where it does fail as a monster movie, however, is in its depiction and level of destruction. You'd think, given the global-wide devastation as seen in Independence Day, that Godzilla would succeed in the same way, but it's oddly subdued. Since this portrayal of Godzilla isn't out to destroy, and in fact actively avoids doing so, there isn't much spectacle to behold. Most of the destruction comes at the hands of the military, who just can't seem to hit the 200-foot-tall giant iguana no matter how hard they try. For example, instead of getting an awesome scene of Godzilla destroying the Chrysler building, it gets taken out accidentally by the military. This takes out the satisfaction of seeing Godzilla do what he is supposed to do best. It's why we watch Godzilla movies, or any giant monster movie for that matter. Emmerich's kaiju movie doesn't even succeed as a kaiju movie, and then you wonder why so many genre fans find this movie disappointing. So after all that rambling, you probably think I hate the 1998 Godzilla. On the contrary, I actually have quite a bit of nostalgia for this movie. I mean, make no mistake, I know it's not a particularly good movie, and as a Godzilla movie, it is insulting, but despite being shocked by all the terrible changes to the character, I made my peace with it pretty soon after I saw it as a kid. I acknowledged the differences and moved on, accepting the fact that there were now two radically different interpretations of the character. And it's not like this film didn't have its positive consequences. Not only did its existence allow Tristar to release all the more recent Godzilla movies of the time stateside for the first time, it also spawned Godzilla the Series, a cartoon sequel sequel that ran on Fox Kids. This cartoon managed to encapsulate the spirit of the late 60s, early 70s era Godzilla movies, while at the same time continuing on from the 1988 film with its own style. Even those that hate that film with a passion love this cartoon. And if you are a Godzilla fan and haven't seen it, I strongly recommend it. In the end, enough time has passed now that the US's first attempt at adapting Godzilla for the masses is just another chapter in a franchise that has run longer than most ever will. The advent of the internet has allowed fans of the kaiju genre and tokusatsu to connect with one another and form communities, and the result is a growing interest in a genre that was once extremely niche. Big blockbuster films like Pacific Rim, Godzilla 2014, and Kong Skull Island have introduced this genre to those less familiar with it, and now it appears we are reaping the results. The 2014 Godzilla is getting at least two sequels, the next one which will feature classic monsters like Rodan, Mothra, and King Ghidorah, and then Godzilla vs. Kong, which is a huge deal, as these two cinematic icons haven't shared the screen since 1962, so they've been long overdue for a rematch. All of this is so exciting, I honestly can't believe it's happening. Meanwhile, Toho is back making Godzilla movies once again, and their latest, last year's Shin Godzilla, was a huge critical and financial hit. Up next for them is Godzilla Monster Planet, the first animated feature film in the franchise. Frankly, it's a great time to be a Godzilla fan, and however you feel about this particular chapter in the franchise, its existence might have been a blessing in disguise. We just had to be patient for it.